once written off by the opinion polls, but re-elected by a landslide. Tsai Ing-wen's stunning reversal of fortune is largely put down to one thing: the growing fear of China, with the events in Hong Kong giving renewed urgency to her message that Taiwan's unique identity and democratic freedoms are best preserved by standing up to the powerful neighbor that claims the island as its own.
Hello, President Tsai.
Hi.
Thank you very much.
But might her strategy, as her critics claim, hurt the economy and risk provoking Beijing?
If we leave aside the question of timetable, the question of practicality, are you, in principle at least, in favour of the idea of formal Taiwanese independence?
The reality and what it is now is that we are already a functionally independent country. And we have our own government and we have our own election.
Will there come a day when that reality needs to be spelled out by a formal declaration of independence?
The idea is that we don't have a need to declare ourselves an independent state, but we are an independent country as already, and we call ourselves Republic of China, Taiwan, and we have our own system of running the country, and we do have government, and we have the military, and we have elections.
Your victory is largely put down to the central position of China in the campaign. Some people would say China has always been a threat in the background. Why was it so different this time round?
Because over the last more than 3 years, we're seeing that China has been intensifying its threat. And they have all sorts of actions, military exercises, and they have their military vessels or aircraft cruising around the island. And also, with the things happening in Hong Kong, people get a real sense that this threat is real and it's getting more and more serious.
You've no doubt that under the one country, two systems formula, Hong Kong's freedoms are being eroded.
Yes, I think so. I mean, there was a time in the past that the people here are very envious, were very envious of the Hong Kong people, because they have this amount of freedom under the British rule. But after 1997, things have changed a lot.
Your predecessor, Ma Ying-jeou, was able to preserve Taiwanese democracy whilst building stronger ties with China, economically and culturally. At a small price, the continued ambiguity over the status of this island, what's not to like about that approach?
But the situation has changed. The ambiguity can no longer serve the purposes that it was intended to serve. So we're facing a very different situation now. And the type of ambiguity that the previous governments wanted to use to preserve some sort of space for both sides, is no longer there.
There's also been talk by your party about the dangers of Chinese influence. Doesn't your landslide victory, though, suggest that those claims were overblown?
Well, I don't call it a landslide victory. It's a convincing one, but not to the extent of landslide. We learned our lesson from the last election, which is a local election, and in that election, fake news, bad rumors, and a lot of other things that are influencing the people's perception here. And as a result, we suffered a lot from that election. So after—
And you've no doubt that's coming from China.
Yes, to a large extent, yes. We have amended quite a number of laws to hold people accountable if they, are distributing this fake news or manufacturing this fake news.
Critics are worried that in itself could be used as an attack on free speech.
Yes, and we do it very carefully so that we keep the right balance.
So just to sum up in terms of where we are with China, something's changed in your view. You don't buy the idea that reverting to the old compromise, that being more ambiguous about Taiwan's status could take us back to a golden era in which the political differences could be kind of shelved and the two sides could get on with just getting rich together.
No, the situation is very different, but I do think that both sides have to think more seriously about the future so that we can coexist for some time and maintain the peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait.
Talk to me a little bit about your election victory. Some people suggesting that it's not just the bigger questions of the immediate strategic challenge from China, but something is changing in Taiwan, particularly the younger generation.
I think the young generation are pretty used to the idea that we're separate. We have a separate identity and we're a country of our own. And if there's anything that runs counter to this idea, they would stand up and say that's not acceptable to us.
How do you expect Beijing to react to your victory?
They should have a serious thought about the people's expectation as expressed by the election result. And this is a very strong message from the people of Taiwan. That is, they don't like the idea of being threatened all the time. They don't like the idea of being undermined all the time. And with such a proud we're such proud people and we have success in every aspect of our lives. Like we're a successful democracy, we have pretty decent economy. We deserve respect from China.
You spoke after the result about your hope that there could be a return to dialogue. How do you begin? What can you offer Beijing that might, in your view, open that door a little?
I think it's for the Chinese to sit down and think and also have this preparedness to face the reality. And that is the key. If they are not prepared to face the reality, whatever we offer won't be satisfying to them.
Can you promise the Taiwanese people that you can stem the flow of diplomatic allies shifting to China? I think you're at 15 now. Do you expect it to stop there?
No, Chinese would definitely never stop their effort to take away our diplomatic allies. But the thing is that we try whatever we can to keep our diplomatic allies.
Isn't the danger, though, that without an expression of good faith on your side, that, and this is what your critics say, that you in a way are inviting China to react in the way that it is?
Building trust is something that is needed, but I think I have been president of this place for more than 3 years. I have been rather reasonable in terms of managing our relation with China, and we have refrained from doing things that may be considered as provocative to China. And we have been adopting this approach of maintaining status quo, despite that there are so much pressure here that we should go further. But in the last more than 3 years, we have been telling China that maintaining status quo remain to be our policy. But and I think that is a very friendly gesture to China.
You've spoken about the rising threat from China. How serious, in your view, is the risk of war today?
You cannot exclude the possibility of a war at any time. But the thing is, you have to get yourself prepared and develop the ability to defend yourself. But in addition to this military preparedness, I mean, what is more important is that you have to get international support for your cause. So we have been adopting this attitude of non-provocation, because we don't want to be the party that is provoking the other side and make the situation worse, or giving the other side the excuse to take whatever action they want to take. And to a certain extent, we're rather mild in our response to, in our view, their provocative actions.
And is Taiwan ready to defend itself? Do you believe you would be able to stand up to a military action?
We have been trying very hard and making a lot of efforts to strengthen our capability. I do think we have a pretty decent capability here. Invading Taiwan is something that is going to be very costly for China.
And are you confident that were that worst case scenario to arrive, that the United States would come to your aid?
Look, we have been working with our friends in the region so that we have a coordinated efforts to maintain peace and stability in the region. So what we intend to do is to continue our efforts with them so that peace and stability can be maintained.
And as you take this stance and shift away from China's sphere of influence and try to build alliances and strengthen your alliance with America, some people would say, where's the real dividend? Still no sign of a free trade agreement with the United States. That seems as far off as ever. The possibility of losing some of these economic ties with China as it punishes you for your stance. Isn't there a risk that the result of all of this will be economic harm?
Well, at a time of change, there's always risk and also challenges, but opportunities as well. I think so far we have been okay in the sense that we utilize this situation to our benefit. So because of these changes, we are given actually a lot of opportunities. I can give you an example. I mean, with this trade conflict between China and the U.S., a lot of our investors in China are now coming back to Taiwan.
Which is something you're encouraging, I think.
Yes, and we encourage them to come back. So when they come back, and establishing their capability here is all state of the art, and also higher end manufacturing capability. And it would bring us that sort of momentum for our economic growth for the next stage.
You've broken the mold in many regards. In particular, for example, your success in getting through the Marriage Equality Act, hugely symbolic. Do you see that as it, perhaps in the end, your biggest legacy?
No, I think I have done quite a few things that people will eventually realize that it's good for the country. For instance, the pension reform, which of course was a very painful process to go through. And of course the same-sex marriage issue is something initially very divisive here, but again, we went through a very painful process to get there. And then we're trying to do a lot of things to reform the judiciary here. To make the system more credible. And green energy is something we have placed a lot of emphasis on.
And how should people measure your success? In 4 years' time, What's your vision?
I want to make this place more democratic. Also, in terms of economy, we'll be much more competitive economic players in the world. We have been doing quite a few things which eventually will make Taiwan the most progressive country in Asia.
Abolition of the death penalty?
That is a difficult issue to deal with.
The one you'd support?
Well, that is perhaps a goal that people always want to achieve, but until people have enough confidence and feel comfortable about it, I don't think we will be able to get enough support for that move.
President Tsai, thank you very much for talking to me. I really appreciate it. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.